Hi, this is M1 Chapter 7, Statics, and I'm going to be using this book right here for this chapter. So, a little bit of a theory at first. Statics means when a particle is stationary. And here we're going to be talking about static equilibrium. Equilibrium is the condition where there is no resultant force acting on a particle. So the up forces are equal to the down forces, right is equal to left, and there are no resultant moments. There are no moments in this chapter, but we are going to be using up equal to down, right equal to left frequently in this chapter. So that being said, let us get on with it. So the first concept that we need is to know how to dissolve forces. So in order to dissolve a force, you have this horizontal plane and this vertical plane. Suppose you have a force in this direction, a force of 10 newtons directed at an angle of 20 degrees. So this force will have two components. One component will be on the right and the other component will be upwards. So the component here will be 10 cos 20. And why is it cos? And this will automatically be 10 sin 20. A rule of thumb that I use to remember which is cos and which is sin is the angle 20 is measured from this plane, from this line to this line. Therefore, here the component will be cos. And the line which does not contain the angle, that line will have the component of sine. So this is how I remember. Moving on, we can go to some examples now. So, okay. First of all, we are going to be doing page number 113, example number 1. Okay. So here you can see a diagram, and there is a an unknown force Q and an unknown force P. So the first thing that we have to do is resolve all the forces in the horizontal and the vertical directions. So we have three forces here. We have force P at an angle of 30 degrees. We have a force 4 newtons at an angle of 45 degrees. And we have a force Q downwards. So first of all, you have to resolve the forces which are not in the vertical and horizontal planes from before. So you have to resolve P because P is not aligned with either the horizontal or the vertical planes. Therefore, P will have a component here, that is P cos 30. And there will be a component here, P sine 30. So you have just resolved P. Similarly, there will be a component of 4 in the upward direction, that is 4 cos 45. And there will be a component of 4 in this direction, 4. Okay, so this is 45 as well. That is why I've written cos 45 here. And here there will be another component, 4 sine 45. Sine 45. So you have resolved 4 as well. Now what you're going to do is you're going to apply the formula. Up is equal to down, and right is equal to left. So let us see which formula we will apply at first. If you apply up is equal to down, then you will see that there is an unknown P here and also an unknown Q here. So you will not be able to find any value. So it is better to use right is equal to left at first. Right is equal to left. By right, I mean the right directive forces, the forces that are acting towards right, that is P cos 30. P cos 30 is equal to 4 sine 45. That's your equation. P is the only unknown. From there, we can find the value of P to be 3.27. Similarly, now you can do up is equal to down because you know the value of P now, up is equal to down. So the upper forces are P sin 30 plus 4 sin 45. But now you know the value of P. So 3.27, that is P sin 30 plus 4 cos 45 equal to Q. So all the other things are known other than except for Q. So Q is equal to 4.46. So this was a fairly simple example where we had to resolve the forces in the upward and the horizontal, the vertical and the horizontal planes. There can be situations though where you have to resolve the forces along the plane and perpendicular to the plane. Let us get to that now. So this should enable you to do exercise 7A number 1 and 2. Now, in case of inclined planes, the rules are a bit different. So for planes, suppose you have a plane like this, and I'm going to be using math number 3B, exercise 7A. We're doing exercise 7A, 3C. This is exercise 7A, number 3, same. So here we have 60 degrees here, and we have this particle here. We have its weight 6 newtons, and we have an upward force Q. We have a perpendicular force to the plane P, and we have a force that is acting in this direction, that is 2. One tip that convention that I use in my answers is that I always take the forces away from the particle. So the force 2 was moving into the particle, so I'm going to just shift this force from here to here, that is 2. It makes the same sense, but this makes my working easier, because then I can resolve the forces more easily. So these are all my forces. Now I'm going to resolve them along the plane and perpendicular to the plane. So this is the thing that you have to keep in mind. For the particles which are not on a plane or which are not on a string, you have to resolve them horizontally and vertically. And for the particles which are on a plane, you have to resolve them along the plane and perpendicular to the plane. So what is the meaning of resolving along the plane? The meaning of resolving along the plane and perpendicular to the plane is you have to write the force, the components of the forces along the plane and perpendicular to the plane. So Q here, this is already along the plane, so we don't have to make any component of Q. But 2 is not along the plane or perpendicular to the plane. So we have to break 2 into two components. One of the components of 2 will go along the plane, that is, the angle here is 60 corresponding angles. So 2 cos 60, this is one component. The other component will be along this direction, that is 2 sine 60. Right. Similarly, you have to break down 6 into two components. So if this is 60, this is 30, then this is 60 once again. So here we will have a component 60, 6 cos 60, and the other components will be here, 6 sine 60. Okay. So now you just have to make sure that all the forces have been broken down into the components, or they are acting along the plane or perpendicular to the plane. So these are all our forces. We have this force P here, this group acting here, this group here, and the other group here. Now what we're going to do is, there are no up is equal to down or right is equal to left, because the forces are inclined. What we're going to do is, we're going to balance the forces perpendicular to the plane away and is equal to into the plane. Like these forces are equal to these forces. So P is equal to 2 sine 60 plus 6 cos 60, right? So that should give you an answer of 4.73. Similarly, these forces are equal to these forces, that is Q plus 2 cos 60 equal to 6 sine 60. Okay. So that should give you a value of Q to be 4.20. So these are your answers for P and Q. The lesson learned here is that you have to resolve the forces along the plane and perpendicular to the plane. Now moving on to a new concept, beads on a string. So if the string is smooth, then the tensions on both parts of the string will be same. For demonstrating this knowledge, we are going to do page number 117. Example number three. So here we have this diagram. Okay. So we have a bead here, and there is a force of 8 newtons acting in this direction. So the angle here is 30. Let us see what the question tells us. A smooth bead Y is threaded on a light inextensible string. Okay, so the bead is smooth. The ends of the strings are attached to two fixed points, Y and X and Z. So this is one end of the string, this is the other end of the string, this is the entire string, and a smooth bead is inserted, is on the string here. The bead is held in equilibrium by a horizontal force of magnitude 8 newtons. So this force is horizontal, and the bead Y is vertically below X. So this bead Y is just vertically below X, okay, as shown in the diagram, right? So the there are two things that we have to find out here. One thing is the tension in the string, and the other is the weight of the bead itself. So the weight of the bead we don't know, so that is W. And the tension, there will be tension in the string since this bead is being pulled here and it is a weight in this direction. But the tensions in both parts of the string will be the same, T, T. That is because the bead is smooth. Here we could apply the formula, half equal to down, but there is one force that we have to break into a component. That is the force T. So we have to break these forces in the vertical plane, this plane, and the horizontal plane. So this T, 8, W, they're all aligned in our yellow lines, but this T is not aligned. Therefore, we have to break it into components. This T, since this is 30 degree, this angle will also be 30 degree. So one component of T will be in this direction, that is T, cos 30. The other component will be in this direction, that is T plus T, sin 30. Okay, so we have just resolved our forces. Here we have a group of forces, here we have another group, here we have a group, here we have another force. So now we can apply the formula, up is equal to down, or right is equal to left. But if you apply up is equal to down, there are two unknowns, T and W. So it is better to find the value of T first using right is equal to left. So right is equal to left, that is T cos 30 is equal to 8. From there you can find the value of T to be 9.24, it is already given in the example. Now you can use the formula up is equal to down, and you know the value of T, that is 9.24. T plus T sin 30, that is 9.24 sin 30, is equal to W. So from there you can find the weight of the bead, that turns out to be 13.9, right? So the lesson learned here is that when the bead is smooth, the tensions on both parts of the string will be the same. Okay. Now, there is one special case where you will resolve the force along the string, along the strings, instead of vertically and horizontally. Such an example is your exercise 7B, number 5. Okay, so here what you can see is we have this string here and we have a bead here at B, and the string goes from A to C, and we have a force of 2 newton here. The angle here is 60 and the angle here is 30. Okay, so what is the angle that the two parts of the string is making here? The angle here is a 90 degree. When this is the case, when the angle near the bead is 90 degree, then you resolve the forces along the strings instead of horizontally and vertically. This will make working a lot more simpler. So what we are going to do now is that we are going to resolve the force along the strings like this instead of horizontally and vertically like we did earlier. So let us see which forces are not along the strings. Let us see whether our bead has a weight or not. Okay, so our bead does have a weight, so the weight will act in this direction, and there will be tensions. The tensions will be here and here. The tensions will be of same magnitude because this is a smooth bead, and we have to resolve the forces. Now, the angle here, since this is a 60 degree, this angle will also be a 60 degree, alternate angles. Therefore, there will be two components of two. One component will be here, the other will be here. So one component here will be T plus 2 cos 60. The other component will be here, that is 2 sine 60. Right. Similarly, W can be divided into two components. One component will be here, the other component will be here. The component in this direction will be, okay, so you have to identify the angle at first. So according to vertical opposite angle, this angle is 60, so this angle must be 30. So the angle here must be W cos 30, and the component here will be W sine 30. Okay, so 2 has been resolved, W has been resolved, and these are all the forces. So we have four groups of forces along the strings. This is one group, this is another force, this is one force, and this is another force. Now what we do is we do, so we do this component is equal to this component, that is T is equal to 2 sine 60 was W sine 30. Okay, so sine 30 is equal to half. That brings down our equation to 0.5 W equal to 2 sine 60. That is one of our equations. Okay, the other equation can be derived like this: T plus 2 cos 60 equal to W cos 30. So T minus cos 30 W, cos 30 has a value of root 3 by 2, W is equal to minus 2 cos 60. Using these two equations, you can solve them simultaneously in your calculator, and then you can find the value of T to be 5.46, which is your answer to part A, and the value of your W, your weight, will be 7.448. But this is the answer to part A. But in part B, they wanted the mass of the particle. Since this is the weight, in order to get the mass, what you do is you just divide the weight by the value of G, that is 9.8, and then you get the value of M to be 0.76. In part C, they're asking you, how have you used the modeling assumption that the bead is smooth in your calculations? So how have we used this fact that the bead is smooth? Well, since the bead is smooth, we have taken the tension T to be same on both sides of the string. That is the answer. Now we will start with the new concept, the concept of limiting equilibrium. So we know that equilibrium is a condition where the forces are balanced, there are no resultant forces. But there is a special equilibrium called the limiting equilibrium, which goes like this. Suppose the maximum friction that a surface can provide is 10 newtons. Okay, so there is a maximum limit of a friction. If you keep pushing something, at one point you cross the friction level and the object starts moving. So that is when you cross the maximum friction. So maybe a surface has a maximum friction level of 10 newtons. Then, if the object is placed on the surface, then if you push with a force of 2 newtons, the activated friction will be 2 newtons, not 10 newtons. Okay, so when you apply a force of 3 newtons, the activated friction will be 3 newtons. In this way, when you apply a force of 10 newtons exactly, the activated friction will also be 10 newtons. This case where the activated friction has reached the maximum level of the friction, the maximum limit of the friction, this scenario is called a limiting equilibrium, right? So what is going to happen when you apply more force, perhaps a force of 12 newtons? If you push the box with a force of 12 newtons, the activated friction will still be 10 newtons because the maximum friction is 10 newtons. It can't increase beyond 10 newtons. Therefore, there will be an acceleration of the box. There will be a resultant force acting on the box, a resultant force of 2 newtons. So that being said, now we know the concept of limiting equilibrium. This value of the maximum friction, this has a formula. The maximum friction can be found using the formula mu r, where r is the normal reaction force between the particle and the surface, this normal reaction force, and mu is a constant called the coefficient of friction. This is called the coefficient of friction. So for demonstrating our knowledge, let us do example number 6 from page number 122. Page number 122, example number 6, right. So we don't have a diagram here, although a diagram is given in the answer, but we are going to learn how to develop the diagram by ourselves, because the diagram is not given in the question itself. There is a box of mass 10 kg resting in limiting equilibrium on a rough plane inclined at 20 degrees above the horizontal. So there is a rough plane. What is the angle of the plane with the horizontal? It is inclined at an angle of 20 degrees to the horizontal. So the plane makes an angle of 20 degrees with what? The vertical or the horizontal? It makes an angle of 20 with the horizontal. And there is a box of mass 10 kg. Therefore, there will be 10g of weight here, and the surface is rough. Find the coefficient of friction between the box and the plane. Right. So the box is in limiting equilibrium. That is, it is just about to fall down. When the box is in limiting equilibrium, we will have a value of friction here. Right. So the box is trying to fall down. Right. So what is preventing it from falling down? The friction. What will be the value of this friction? The value of this friction will be the maximum friction possible. How did we understand that the friction will be the maximum friction? That is because they have said the box is in limiting equilibrium. Being in limiting equilibrium means that the friction has reached its maximum value. What is that maximum value? That the maximum value is equal to mu r. The mu is the coefficient of friction that we have to find out, and the r is the normal reaction force between the particle and the plane, r. So this is what you have to find, the coefficient of friction, mu. So first of all, let us resolve all the forces. We have given the normal reaction, the friction, the weight. Now we have to resolve the forces along the plane and perpendicular to the plane. So that friction is already along the plane, so we don't have to do anything about it. The normal reaction is already perpendicular to the plane, so we don't have to do anything about it. We have to resolve the force 10g. The angle here is 20, so there will be a component here, 10g cos 20, and a component here, 10g sine 20. These are the two components of 10g, and it has been resolved. Now we can find out the value of r. This force is equal to this force, so r is equal to 10g cos 20. So r is equal to 92.1 newtons. Right, so now we know the value of r, so we can find the value of our coefficient of friction. That is, we equate this force is equal to this force. So this force is mu r, that is mu into r. We now know the value of r, that is 92.089 was here, and this force is 10g sine 20. From there, the value of mu turns out to be 0.36. That is our answer to part A. So for part B, we have to draw a new diagram because we have a new force. Whenever there is a new force, the situation changes. You should change the diagram as well. So the force is 20 as before. We have a particle of mass 10 kg. So here is 10g. Now we have a new force of P, right? So how do I know that the force P is acting in this direction? Because the particle was already in its limiting equilibrium without this force P. If I had provided the force P in this direction, the particle would have automatically slided down. So the force P will be towards the plane. Now, what will be the maximum value of P? For this, the friction will be, if the value of P is maximum, such that the box is still in equilibrium, then the friction will act in this direction. Okay? Like, think about it. The force P is trying to push this particle up the plane. Therefore, the friction will act in the backward direction, that is, downward. So we will have the normal reaction force here, and that's it. Now we're going to resolve these forces along the plane and perpendicular to the plane. The angle here is 20. The angle here is also 20, corresponding forces. So P can be resolved in this direction and in this direction. P cos 20, P sine 20. So P has been resolved. Similarly, we can resolve 10. 10 can be resolved in this direction and in this direction. Therefore, 10g cos 20 and f plus 10g sin 20. These are the two components of 10g. Now we have resolved all the forces along the plane and perpendicular to the plane. We have four groups of forces. Now what we are going to do is, we are going to equate these forces. So we know the value of F, and the value of F should be equal to mu R. So if we equate these two forces, that is, this force is equal to this force. This force is P cos 20. P cos 20. That is equal to 10G sin 20. 10G sin 20 plus F. This F is the maximum value of friction. How do I know that? Because the particle is in the limiting equilibrium. How do I know the particle is in limiting equilibrium? Because we are talking about the maximum value of P. The moment we reach the maximum value of P is the moment where if we increase the value of P any further, the particle will start to move. So that point is called the limiting equilibrium, and that is how I know the maximum value of friction is acting. What is the formula for maximum friction? Mu r. The value of mu we found to be 0.36, and the value of r we still don't know. We have to find out the value of r. Right. So p equals 20 minus 0.36 r is equal to 10 g sine 20. Right. So this is one equation, equation number one. The other equation will be this is equal to this. So this force is r, that is equal to p sine 20 plus 10 g cos 20. So if I rearrange the equation, p sine 20 minus r will be equal to minus 10 g cos 20. That is equation number two. If you resolve these two equations, then you can find out the value of P to be 82. They haven't told us to find out the value of R, so we leave our answer up to here. So that is all the knowledge that you need for doing the math, but I'm going to solve one more math which proves to be particularly challenging. So that will be exercise 7C. Number 11. Let us draw the diagram at first. We have a box here. We have a force of T here. This is acting at an angle of 20 degrees. And we have an angle of 40 degrees here. Excuse me. Let us put the forces first. Read with me. A box of mass 0.5 kg. So the box has a mass of 0.5 kg. Therefore, the weight will be 0.5 g. Is placed on a plane which is inclined at an angle of 40 degrees to the horizontal. The coefficient of friction between the box and the plane is 1 by 5. So the value of mu is 1 by 5. The box is kept in equilibrium by a light string which lies in a vertical plane. This lies in a vertical plane containing a line of greatest slope of the plane. So there is a string here. There is a string here and it is keeping the box in equilibrium. Right, so okay, so we have a string here. The string makes an angle of 20 degree with the plane. Oh, okay, so the string is here itself. This is the string itself. This is not another string. Here is the string. So the string makes an angle of 20 degrees with the plane. This is the string. The box is in limiting equilibrium and may be modeled as a particle. The tension in the string is T, as shown in the diagram. Find the range of possible values of T. So, there can be two values of T. The value of T can be so large that the particle will be just about to move up the plane, and the value of T could be so small that the particle would just be on the point of slipping down the plane. So let us do the case of the particle about to move up the plane at first. The particle is just about to move up the plane. In that case, the friction will be acting in the downward direction because the particle is just about to move in the upward direction. The friction will act in the opposite direction. When the particle is just about to move upwards, we understand that the particle is in limiting equilibrium because if the value of T increases any further, the particle will just start moving. So friction has reached its maximum value. So what is the formula for maximum friction? The formula is mu r. Mu is the coefficient of friction, which is 1 by 5, and r is the normal reaction here. The first thing that we have to do is we have to resolve the forces along the plane and perpendicular to the plane. So the component of 0.5g will there will be two components. One component will be here, the other will be here. So the component in this direction will be 0.5g cos 40, and here the component will be 0.5g sin 40. So 0.5g has been resolved. Similarly, T can be divided into two components, one in this direction, the other in this direction. So let me erase this mu so that it doesn't get confusion. So one component will be here, that is T cos 20. The other component will be in this direction, that is T sin 20. So T has been broken into its components as well. So now we have all the components broken up. We have these forces, this force, and this group of forces. Now, if we equate this force is equal to this force, then we get an equation. T cos 20, this force is equal to this force, that is mu r, mu is equal to 1 by 5, but r we don't know, r plus 0.5 g sin 40. So T cos 20 minus 1 by 5 r is equal to 0.5 g sin 40. So this is our equation number 1. Similarly, the other equation we can do like this. This force is equal to this force, that is T sin 20 plus R is equal to 0.5 g cos 40. That is equation number 2. If you solve these two value, these two equations simultaneously on a calculator, then you can find the value of T to be 3.87. This is the value of T. The maximum value of T is 3.87. If you increase the value of T any further, the particle will start accelerating up the plane. Now, there is another situation where the particle will start accelerating down the plane. So for that, we have to draw another diagram because the direction of the friction will change now. So we will have all the forces just like before, but the direction of the friction will reverse. 20. We have the weight just like before, 0.5 g. We have the normal reaction r, but now the value of T is such that it is on a minimum value. If you decrease the value of T any further, the particle will accelerate down the plane. So that T is such that the particle is on the point of sliding down the plane. So on the point of sliding down the plane. Down. So the value of friction, the friction will be acting in the opposite direction to the tending motion of the particle. The particle is tending to move down the plane, therefore the friction will act in this direction, friction. And this value of friction will be maximum because the particle is about to move down the plane, the friction has reached its maximum value, so its maximum value is equal to mu r, according to the formula that we know. Now what we have to do is resolve the forces along the plane and perpendicular to the plane. The angle here is 40, so once again 0.5 will have a component here and here. So 0.5 g cos 40, 0.5 g sin 40. Similarly, T will have a component here and a component here. So T cos 20 plus T sin 20. So we have resolved T, we have resolved 0.5 g, and we have all the forces along the plane and perpendicular to the plane. So these are the forces. Right. So now once again we make the equations. The first equation that we make is this is equal to this. So the force in this direction are F plus T cos 20. So F is equal to mu R, and mu was equal to 1 by 5 as given in the question. R we don't know. T also we don't know. T cos 20 is equal to this force, that is 0.5 g sin 40. So this is our equation number 1. The other equation is this force is equal to this force. So here we have this force, that is T sin 20 plus R is equal to 0.5 g cos 40. This is equation number 2. If you solve these two forces simultaneously, these two equations simultaneously, you get the value of T to be 2.75, and this is the minimum value of T. If you reduce the value of T any further, then the particle will start accelerating down the plane. Therefore, our previous value of T was 3.87 and our minimum value is 2.75. Therefore, our T can vary from the minimum value, which is 2.75, to the maximum value, that is 3.87. This is the range of values of T for which the particle will be in equilibrium. So now you should be able to do exercise 7C and exercise the chapter review number 7. If you need help with any particular math, please let me know in the comment section below. And if you found this video useful, please subscribe and press the bell icon. This encourages me to make more videos for you. Thank you very much for watching.